Oh, a vicious series of abdominal blows. This will surely go down in the annals as a battle for the ages. Not since Agamemnon laid siege to Troy has the world witnessed such astonishing brutality. What? Too much? Dear Tim and Moby, can you tell me a little bit about Muhammad Ali? Sincerely, Perry. Muhammad Ali is one of the most iconic athletes of the 20th century. He was three-time heavyweight boxing champ during the 1960s and 70s. His superior talent and creativity let him dominate in the ring. But he's remembered as much more than just a big-time boxer. Ali rose to prominence amid the emerging civil rights movement, the struggle to overturn racist policies targeting African Americans. From the start of his career, he was a symbol of the changing times. African Americans, even those in the spotlight, were supposed to be quiet and humble. Ali was unwilling to play by those rules and instead freely spoke his mind, which forced Americans to think about the treatment of black people in our country. Ali was born Cassius Clay in Louisville, Kentucky in 1942. Growing up, he witnessed the bias and brutality of segregation firsthand. He couldn't understand why he couldn't go where white people went or do what they did. Cassius was particularly affected by the death of Emmett Till, a 14-year-old boy murdered after being accused of whistling at a white woman. The racial violence of that era left Cassius confused and angry. Boxing gave him a chance to channel those emotions. He immediately stood out for his astonishing speed. His quick reflexes and footwork made him nearly impossible to hit, and his hands were lightning fast. As an amateur fighter, he racked up over 100 wins and took home the gold at the 1960 Summer Olympics. As a pro, he developed a style that was all his own. During bouts, he'd dance around, shuffling his feet and circling opponents, ducking and dodging blows as fighters grew frustrated. The constant movement eventually wore people down, leaving them open to Clay's deadly counterpunches. That's what led to his famous tagline, "Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee." Clay often spoke in freestyle rhymes at interviews and press conferences. His confidence and charm helped him become a media superstar. Reporters ate up his lyrical delivery and ready-made sound bites. Clay had adapted his routine from the world of pro wrestling. He liked how they used to swagger and boast to rile up viewers. True, he was also kind of abrasive. He'd taunt his opponents, predicting exactly what round they'd get knocked out. Traditional fans and older folks thought he was arrogant, but Clay knew that whether he was booed or cheered, it helped fill the seats. And that would be the key to getting a shot at the championship belt. It finally came in 1964, when he faced Sonny Liston. Even in the world of heavyweight boxing, Liston was a scary figure. A big, brawny fighter with a brutal knockout punch. But Clay frustrated him at every turn. At the beginning of the seventh round, Liston refused to leave his corner. Amid the frenzy inside the ring, Clay shouted that he shook up the world. And what he was about to do outside the ring really did. Soon after the fight, Clay joined the Nation of Islam, a fringe Muslim sect. They believed racism was a permanent part of American culture. And their goal was to create an entirely separate country for black people. Nation of Islam recruits would often change their last names, since those were passed down from slave owners. That's why Cassius Clay became Muhammad Ali. He quickly became a symbol of African-American pride and rising racial tensions. The theatrics he once relied on to drum up interest in his fights, he now used to send a message about racial injustice. It was the same idea behind his refusal to enter the armed forces. The U.S. was in an escalating conflict with Vietnam halfway around the world. Many young men were being called up or drafted to serve in the military. Ali stated that his religious background prevented him from fighting. He also questioned the purpose of the war itself, asking reporters why he should fight for a country that treated his people so poorly. His views on war and religion didn't really help his reputation, and his fight against the draft cost him dearly. He was stripped of his title and barred from boxing anywhere in the U.S. His legal battle took years as the case went all the way to the Supreme Court. Over that time, public opinion turned against the Vietnam War, and landmark legislation made the dream of civil rights a reality. The country had caught up to Ali and his beliefs. He also broke ties with the Nation of Islam, converting to a mainstream sect. Ali returned to the ring in 1970, but he was never quite the same. He'd been sidelined for nearly four of his prime fighting years. Heavier and slower, he couldn't use pure speed to outduel boxers. The greatest was no longer invincible. But ironically, the decline in skill led to his most epic battles. Three grueling bouts against Joe Frazier created the most celebrated rivalry in boxing history. Ali lost the first fight when Frazier held the championship. By the time he got another shot at the title, Ali was 32 years old and well past his prime. This time, the belt was in the hands of George Foreman. Foreman had easily crushed fighters who'd given Ali trouble, including Frazier. But what Ali lacked in pure ability, he made up for in smarts. He leaned back on the ropes and covered up in the early rounds. After Foreman had exhausted himself, Ali shocked the world by knocking out the younger, stronger man. It seemed he won through sheer force of will. Even those who hated his politics had to admire his heart. Ali became even more beloved after he hung up his gloves in 1979. Over the next four decades, he focused on humanitarian and charitable work. He focused much of his efforts on helping children in poorer nations. Even when his health declined due to Parkinson's disease, he kept on fighting, raising awareness about the disease by staying in the spotlight. His life came full circle at the 1996 Atlanta Olympics. With billions cheering across the globe, he lit the opening ceremony flame. Yeah, Ali's place in our culture had totally changed between those two Olympic moments. But his voice has always been the same, defiant and insightful. Although he died in 2016, for many fans, he'll always be the greatest.